A new Linux kernel bug was discovered. DDoS just got huge, and Russia gets hit with cyber attacks and bans. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for March 15, 2022. This is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. We've got some new attacks to cover this week, so on to the first news story. A new security vulnerability is affecting Linux distribution kernels. It's called Dirty Pipe. Its CVE number is CVE-2022-0847, and it's pretty severe with a CVSS score of 7.8. Now, Dirty Pipe could allow an attacker to overwrite arbitrary data into read-only files and could also allow them to take over an exploited system in a privilege escalation. This was discovered by Max Kellerman, software developer at Ionos. Although just discovered, it appears that this flaw has been around since version 5.8, which was released back in August of 2020. It has been fixed in Linux kernel versions 5.16.11, 5.15.25, and 5.10.102. This happens because an unprivileged process could inject code into root processes. According to Red Hat, stale values could be contained in the kernel due to a couple of pipe or pipeline functions lacking proper initialization. An attacker would need to create a pipe, fill it with a bunch of arbitrary data, drain the pipe, use a read-only file to splice this data, and then write arbitrary data into the pipe. A proof of concept has been shared by Kellerman. Pipelines let processes in Linux send data back and forth between each other as standard input and standard output. Now, if that sounds unfamiliar, I did a hack tip video about pipes and pipelines years and years ago on the channel. You can still find it on the channel as well. The problem was patched 3 days after being reported. Now, Google merged a fix into the Android kernel back in February as well, though this affects Android devices running on the affected Linux kernels. Linux distro users should update and apply these patches ASAP, especially given that a proof of concept working exploit has been shared. Let's talk about DDoS attacks, because this is really interesting. DDoS, or distributed denial of service attacks, are pretty commonplace now, and they are used to target a website or a network or a server with a ton of ping requests and data in order to slow them down to a crawl to the point where it causes an outage. During these kinds of attacks, there's an amplification ratio, and the higher that number can get, the more a target can get overwhelmed. Insecure devices can be used as reflectors or amplifiers in a DDoS attack, and that's exactly what is happening here. Several backbone internet companies, including Akamai, Cloudflare, Mitel, and more, disclosed a new vulnerability that causes a packet amplification ratio of 4 billion, that's with a B, to 1 from a single packet. Now, to put this into perspective, previous amplifications have increased a DDoS's attack volume by 556 times, 50 times, or 51,000 times. So this one's pretty big at 4 billion times. That's a lot. That's record-breaking. In this case, a little packet gets reflected over and over again in a closed network until it reaches its maximum size. Then that packet is redirected towards the target. The CVE for this flaw is CVE-2022-26143, and it exists within the Mitel MyCollab and Mitel MyVoice Business Express PBX to Internet Gateway systems. These systems have test modes that should not be connected and exposed to the internet, but very much are via a daemon listening for commands via UDP-10074. The test mode can be used to send a DDoS attack that lasts for 14 hours via that one single spoofed packet. The DDoS attack could be sustained at about 393 megabits per second, and this affects around 2,600 exposed devices, according to Akamai. Now, couldn't it be flagged as suspicious? Well, according to researchers at the Shadow Server Foundation, quote, this single packet attack initiation capability has the effect of precluding network operator traceback of the spoofed attack initiator traffic. This helps mask the attack traffic generation infrastructure, making it less likely that the attack origin can be traced compared with other UDP reflection and amplification DDoS attack vectors. Mitel systems only send one command at a time, though, so a user could notice that the system is unavailable for several hours. Otherwise, the best course of action is to update the Mitel systems and detect and block strange traffic on UDP port 10074 and disable the test command. Ports 80 and 443 were also affected as well, and attacks have been seen in the wild targeting financial institutions, governments, and logistics companies. Before I get to story number three, I want to say a big shout out to my Hush Puppy perk level patrons for sharing their fur baby photos and for the support. And I love the new one, it's so cute. Thank you so much to Kyle C and Kasira for joining on patreon.com/threatwire, and shout out to everyone who supports the show. Let's go ahead and finish out today's episode with my last top story about Russia getting blocked and banned from all the things. Now, to follow up with my last few videos regarding the Russian and Ukrainian conflict, which actually affects all of us, y'all have likely heard about the sanctions, right? I'm assuming that you have if you've been following along. The US, along with allies and partners, have imposed sanctions on Russia and Belarus, making it much harder for these two countries to conduct business internationally. In an alert shared by the Treasury Department's Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, or FinCEN, financial firms should keep an eye out for any attempts made to thwart those sanctions. FinCEN has specifically warned that sanctions could be bypassed via money laundering techniques tied to payments from ransomware attacks. Now, this also means we might see more attacks targeting US companies or its partners used to lower some of that economic impact that Russia may see. FinCEN notes that some red flags that could indicate sanction evasion include using cryptocurrency payments, for example. If a customer conducts multiple quick trades, then an off-platform transaction, that could be a sign of someone trying to obfuscate a transaction. Cryptocurrency mixing or transactions that have been related to ransomware could also be signs. As such, FinCEN is planning to create a compliance guidelines for cryptocurrency organizations, and President Biden signed an executive order last week about evading sanctions with digital assets. Civilians in Russia are experiencing down sites due to those sanctions because websites can't renew their TLS certificates and browsers could block expired ones. So Russia created its own trusted TLS certificate authority to get around this problem. The Russian Ministry of Digital Development provides this service when a cert is revoked or expires. But since it takes a while for these to be approved by international browsers like Chrome and Firefox, etc., users are told to use Yandex or Atrum products instead because those are Russian-based. Now, the concern is that these certificates could be used by the Russian government to perform man-in-the-middle attacks against those using them, which would render them invalid in most browsers, leading to them being blocked or included in a CRL, or a certificate revocation list. Meanwhile, this cyber battle rages on. Several Russian sites belonging to federal agencies have experienced supply chain attacks, which were used to compromise said sites and replace their content with pro-Ukrainian imagery. A state-owned Russian aerospace and defense site called Rostec was taken down in a DDoS attack, and this one was attributed to the Ukrainian IT Army. Lumen Technologies, a company based here in the US who is in charge of routing lots of internet traffic, announced that they will not be routing internet traffic for any organizations based in Russia anymore. The company mentioned that they have not seen any direct disruptions, but there is a security risk to doing business with Russian-based organizations, and as such, they have ceased those operations. Two other big internet backbones are Cloudflare and Akamai, who have both stated that they will continue operating in Russia. Both companies argue that pulling the plug on the internet access for Russian citizens would do more harm than good, stating that people need access to worldwide media and world news, not just whatever media Russia provides. Both companies also condemn the Russian invasion of Ukraine, and they are taking steps to help, such as ramping up defenses and joining partner orgs like CrowdStrike to provide free resources for cybersecurity. Akamai is ceasing sales efforts in the country of Russia as well. Cloudflare removed customer encryption keys from data centers in the conflicting countries, and they deployed keyless SSL technology instead. They are also bricking servers that go offline in Ukraine, Belarus, or Russia due to power loss or internet disruption, and they can only be unblocked if a specific key for that machine is inputted, but those keys are not stored on site. Russia is banning Instagram a week after disabling Facebook and Twitter access in response to the parent company Meta allowing posts calling for violence against Russian soldiers if the posts originate from certain countries. The country at the time gave users 48 hours to move off of Instagram before the social media platform would be disabled within the country. Cisco Talos posted a threat advisory on Wednesday about a DDoS tool making rounds that is being circulated for Ukrainian activists, but this tool is actually a Trojan called the Phoenix InfoStealer. Phoenix has been around for a couple of years and is actually a keylogger, so it can be used to steal cryptocurrency as well as credentials. Google's threat analysis group has also seen phishing campaigns happening that originate from Russian state-sponsored groups like Fancy Bear or Ghostwriter, which are targeting the Ukrainian media company URKNet. TAG also alerted authorities to their findings. Now, if you see something happening that I haven't touched on with regards to the cyber attacks, feel free to leave a comment so that I can keep everyone updated as much as possible, because this is ongoing. This battle between countries, I don't think it's going to end anytime soon. Do you want to see more tech videos from me? Check out my YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/Shannon Morse for everything from tech reviews to security tutorials. And with that, do not forget to like and subscribe to Hack5. I'm Shannon Morse, and I'll see you on the internet.